All right. So yeah, we've covered positioning the microphone. We've covered setting up the correct gain. We talked a little bit about some of the other hardware features that you might have on your audio interface, including some of those more specific to Wave XLR. And lastly, we come to some more of the really software-focused features, and we're going to talk about VSTs now. In this context, we're going to talk about them when they're used in Wavelink. If you are using, a different audio interface, because you know you can use WaveDX with any audio interface that supports XLR, then you know it might be different for you. But in this case, we're going to talk about essentially Wave XLR, Wavelink, and using some of the VSTs in there. And really, to get started, we're very excited that together with WaveDX, we've also released our first EQ VST or Equalizer VST. Do you want to talk a little bit about what that is and does, Brett?
So the Elgato EQ VST, which is short for Equalization or Equalizer, is an effect where you can control certain sections of your audio signal. I'm trying not to hit the mic here. But imagine a spectrum of frequencies. You have your low frequencies all the way to your high frequencies. And you can control each individual section differently, or essentially raising or lowering the volume of these certain sections. Now, this VST has some presets to get you started with what you're trying to achieve. Maybe you want to add a little bit of bass. Maybe you want to add a little bit of high-end frequency to add some clarity. But with this VST, which is known as a parametric equalizer, or has parameters, essentially, what that means is you don't just have defined sliders that control certain sections. You can sort of freely change how wide of a range you control, or how much you control, or how narrow the band of frequencies you want to control is. So it's really pretty customizable in what you can do with it. And so you can just experiment with, you know, maybe going overboard just to see what it sounds like. A lot of times with EQ, if you're just trying to make your audio sound just a little bit different, you only need a decibel, maybe two for the most part. But, you know, experiment with it. It's free to download from Elgato.com. We have some great videos talking about equalization on the Elgato Workshop channel. And we'll have some great resources for learning how to use this EQ VST.
Yeah, the timing here is really nice because when we did some testing on WaveDX, and the way we designed it, it essentially offers a very kind of flat sound signature. So it doesn't add too much of its own color. It generally, you know, the term coloring comes to mind, like, oh, it has its own, you know, how like speakers, like some speakers sound a little bit harsher, some sound a little bit warmer, right? And they kind of color the tone a little bit. And so with WaveDX, it's got a very neutral frequency response. You know, it keeps that line very flat. And so that gives you a little bit more leeway to change how it sounds or the tone of the microphone by using an EQ. And with those presets, it'll make it very easy. You can just select one, pick, you know, if you want a little bit more bass, you can just do that. If you want more vocal clarity, that'll pitch up the frequencies around like the 500 to 2000 megahertz range. Is megahertz right? Yeah, that is right, right? No?
Just hertz.
Kilohertz, hertz. That hurts internally. So then we just cut that. So yeah, we've got the Equalizer. Great movie, by the way. Don't know if you've seen it. But yeah, we've got the EQ VST, which we just released. And then a little while ago, we also released a noise suppression VST featuring the NVIDIA Broadcast SDK. And this is really great if you have background noise that you want to get rid of. Now, of course, WaveDX is already going to handle that quite well due to its dynamic capsule nature. But if you've got a keyboard or a lot of wind in the background, or maybe there's construction going on, you know, that stuff can still get through. So now we're going to talk a little bit about how you can get rid of some of the noise. And generally with noise, you want to take a light-handed approach to start, because noise suppression can also affect the sound of your microphone. As you start removing potentially background noise, you may also start dipping into removing parts of your voice, which you don't want. And so one of the first effects that actually doesn't affect your sound at all is a noise gate. And we have a video on that. So Brett's the expert on what a noise gate does.
I don't know about that, but I've certainly talked about him a lot. So yeah, we have a video up on Workshop, Elgato Workshop, And that's talking about noise reduction in a general sense. So we feature a noise gate VST in that video, as well as some other more proper filtering audio effects in there that actually build a sound profile and then remove that from future parts of your recording or your signal. So a noise gate is generally the starting place. So we talked a little bit about low-cut filters. In a way, low-cut filters could be seen as a very primitive form of noise reduction because it's usually just rumble that's happening in your environment. But a noise gate is sort of the next step where, generally speaking, a noise gate has kind of like one parameter. It has a threshold. And that is when the signal is above this point, allow the signal to come through. And if the signal is below this threshold, mute it. It's very simple like that. Now, of course, there are other audio effects out there that have certain other parameters in there. But essentially, it is a way to just completely mute your signal when you're not speaking. So if your voice is notably louder than anything that's going to happen in your environment, your keyboard typing, any tapping on your desk, or you know, neighbors or something, a noise gate can be a really quick and really lightweight way to just completely remove that, because if it's quiet enough, a noise gate's just going to completely, essentially mute it when you're not speaking.
You can think of it as kind of like an auto muter, where it just, yeah, it mutes you when you're quiet and it unmutes you when you start talking. Noise gate is great to use because it doesn't affect the actual sound, right? It just lets sound through or it doesn't. And especially when you're playing games, if you're streaming games, for example, where there's going to be a little bit of background noise anyways, it might be music from, you know, the game, or there's some people talking, NPCs, just kind of hustle and bustle. A noise gate is great there because the sound that might come through or that might get through a noise gate, even some like loud keyboard typing, you know, the game is probably going to like muddy that all together. And so a noise gate is like really the first kind of approach to combating noise. If you, however, still have noise after using a noise gate, you can start to become a little bit more aggressive with, I guess the next step would be just like a basic frequency removal. And Brett touched on that a little bit. There's one effect that is in the workshop video called Rhea, is it Rhea Fur?
Yeah, which...
Finite impulse response.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think the developers expected people to pronounce it, but yeah, it's R-E-A-F-I-R.
It's kind of just a dumb frequency removal, right? Like you analyze your background sound without, yeah, well, I mean, basic. It's basic frequency removal. So the way it works is you just stop talking and it creates a profile of what your background noise is, or essentially what the noise is when you're not talking at all. And then you create that profile and then you can continue talking and it'll just remove or subtract all of the frequencies that it analyzed previously. So this does work really nice if you've got a fairly regular kind of background noise. This might be something like a fan, you know, like a, yeah. Like an AC that has a very regular tone. However, if you have like dogs barking or cars driving by, it might not work as well because those, you know, they don't always sound the same, right? Dog barks, they're going to be different. Cars are going to have different sounds. So it wouldn't then work as well. And that's where the kind of the third stage of aggressive noise removal can come in, which is more of like actual analyzing the audio. And we've got two there at this point, I believe. One is the NVIDIA noise removal, and then we've got another one based on a technology called RN noise. So what are NVIDIA noise removal and RN noise?
So both of these algorithms are based on AI models. And it is a very lightweight algorithm that runs on your CPU and can do a pretty good job of removing any sort of randomized noise. So we talked about how that previous audio effect, refer, it is generating a static sound profile where you can, like Phil was talking about earlier, it can remove really consistent sounds, but those dog barks, anything where there's keyboard typing, anything that is not part of the sound profile is, for the most part, let through. Whereas with RN noise and other AI noise reduction algorithms, they are able to account for those based on the way they were trained. Now, if you move up to NVIDIA Broadcast Noise Removal, the VST that we have available for free on Elgato.com, but essentially, if you have an RTX GPU, It is a very advanced AI noise suppression algorithm that runs on the GPU itself, not on your CPU. So when you're playing games, you're streaming, all that work is done being done by your GPU, which is very fast and very optimized for that type of workload, and not on your CPU. RN noise is very lightweight, but for the most part, NVIDIA broadcast noise removal just does a better job.
That's because there are also some slight but still significant differences between the two, in that the NVIDIA noise removal is really, it's been trained. We actually had Gerardo, product manager at NVIDIA, who kind of spearheaded this. He was talking about how they actually trained it on various different sounds, right? So they trained it on what a keyboard sounds like. They trained this AI model on what a dog sounds like, what a washer and dryer sound like, all these different things that you might find commonly around a house or that might be next to a setup, and to teach it what that is. And then it actually figures out, okay, this is human speech. This is a washer and dryer. I'm just going to remove the washer and dryer sound, or the washer sound. I don't know why I keep saying both. I'm just going to remove this one sound and not everything. And so that gives you a much better noise removal without affecting your voice too much. And the results there have been really impressive, and they're constantly improving it over time, you know, training this machine learning algorithm to be even better, to recognize more sounds. And that's pretty much like the most aggressive thing you can use. And it does a really fantastic job. I mean, we've tested it where we hold a fan right up to the microphone, talk into the mic, and it actually does a decent job of removing it, which is absolutely crazy.
Yeah, you just toggle on that effect and suddenly it's like the fan just vanished in terms of audio. It's really crazy.
It's like magic. Yeah, you actually made a really cool clip to show it. Maybe we'll throw it up here.
What if you could remove the noise from your audio automagically? Well, with the power of AI and NVIDIA RTX, you can.
But yeah, that will take care of pretty much anything. So if you just want to take kind of the brute force approach of, okay, I'm just removing everything, if you have an RTX GPU, throw that on there, and then it'll take care, and you don't need to worry about pretty much any sounds ever again.
I think as a general rule, based on my own experience, if you need a hearing protection, that's when the filter might begin to affect your voice. But if you need hearing protection, I think you should remove the thing that's causing, concert levels of noise from your microphone.
And then the last effect we should talk about, which kind of goes in the direction of clip guard, but it's a little bit different, is a limiter. This is a type of effect which we also have a workshop video on. Brett has made a video. It's a fantastic one that covers kind of compressors and limiters. But a limiter, kind of how the name implies, just simply limits the sound and the volume of the sound. So Brett, why would that be useful?
So a limiter is a very simple audio effect where as the signal approaches some defined threshold, the signal is just, it's not clipped, but it's prevented from getting any louder. There are various ways you can accomplish this, but if you're familiar with compression, then you're probably familiar with limiters. But in any case, a limiter is kind of compression with an infinite ratio. So instead of slowing down how much it clamps the signal, it just hits a brick wall, and it's not allowed to go any higher. Now, the thing is, unlike clip guard, which is designed to sound almost kind of transparent, like you don't really know that you're hitting clip guard. It sounds like you. It's not affecting your sound quality. A limiter, you will sound different because it is working with a digital signal. It's not working with the analog sort of pre-processed audio that's happening in the case of clip guard. With a limiter, you are limited in what you can accomplish in terms of reducing your maximum volume without affecting how clear the audio is. So you'll sound a bit different. Actually, in the case of Wavelink, clip guard is in the microphone or in Wave XLR. But in the case of other channels in Wavelink, you can add a limiter to those and, you know, prevent those from getting too loud. If you're playing games, playing with some other people who are getting really loud, you can essentially set a maximum volume for those audio sources.
That's actually really nice, because sometimes if you do hit that kind of that digital zero, that maximum, that 0 decibels, it can have all sorts of negative effects on in terms of like just the volume level, or maybe someone tunes into your stream and, you know, they have their laptop running at 75% volume and they click on your stream and boom, they're just hit by this extremely loud sound. So using a limiter is nice, especially if you apply it to the different channels, because you can ensure that your friends are never too loud. You can ensure that the game you're playing is always at a, is always going to be a little bit quieter than you are, so that people can always hear you. You can put it on yourself just to ensure that, you know, you never get too loud. Maybe you set it to a limit of like -5 dB or something like that, and then, you know, you're never going to hit that zero number. And so a limiter is just a good idea to use if you're concerned about just being too loud overall. And again, with Wavelength, yeah, it's cool. You can just apply it to all your different channels. If you have music, same thing there. You can just ensure that the music never gets too loud. Or I think in my case, I probably use it mostly for my voice chat channel.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, Brett, where would you use it?
Probably game audio, actually, because I run pretty strong compression on my voice when I stream. But the game is sort of, it's meant to sound good to me, not necessarily to viewers. So in Wavelength, I can add these limiters and compression just for my viewers, but it sounds the same to me. I did want to quickly point out, though, someone may be watching thinking to themselves, why don't you just lower the volume of the channel? But the thing is, with a limiter, you can maintain a lot of the volume so everything comes through clearly without getting too loud. If you just lower everything, if you're in a voice chat and someone's a little bit quieter, they're going to sound even quieter. So with a limiter or compression, you can sort of push a lot of the quiet areas up, and so they all come through more clearly.
All right, that's fantastic. So then I think that'll do it for us here. Thank you, Brett, for spending the time and putting this together. And for everyone watching this, I hope you learned something today. I'm curious if you guys like this format, if you want us to take a deeper dive on anything, it doesn't just have to be audio, it could be any of our Elgato products, then, you know, let us know in the comment section below. I always enjoy doing this stuff. I could spend hours and hours and hours talking about various different things.
We do.
We just don't put it on our YouTube channel. But yeah, so if you guys would like to see more of this, let us know in the comments down below and then we can make it happen. And yeah, is there any last thing you want to leave with our viewers?
I don't think so, but I'm going to shout out Elgato Workshop once more, because we have a lot of great content on there that I produced with my own voice. If you like how I sound, then you might like those videos too. And a lot of those videos, like with limiters, compression, noise reduction, videos on Wavelength and audio effects and all that, do pertain to WaveDX if you are using Wave XLR. And we'll have links to those all in the description. But yeah, I suppose that's all for me. This is, we covered a lot today, I think.
We definitely did. So, and also if you stuck through to the end, there's no prize here except thank you for watching. Have a good one.
Thanks for watching.